I'm excited to be talking to you about brain health and neurofeedback. So let's just take a minute to talk about what does it mean to have a healthy brain. We all understand what it means to have, you know, a healthy body, healthy heart. We need to exercise it. We need to feed it the right foods. But we don't really think about brain health and the fact that we need to exercise our brains so that our brains function at their best cognitively and emotionally, and that foods impact how our brain functions. One cool study that was done and looked at all the countries in the world to see what country's lifestyle has the most conducive to brain health. And what their research found was that Spain is the top country in terms of the factors in their lifestyle that contributes to brain health and longevity. So the average lifespan in Spain is 83. And the factors in their lives are they eat a very healthy Mediterranean diet, they're low smokers, they have a good public health care system. In general, they get good exercise and have clean water, and all of those factors lead them to be the best country to live in if you want a healthy brain. So the change in our thinking is to think about that if we're not functioning well cognitively, we're having problems with our memory, or we're having issues with executive functioning, or if our mood is fluctuating, that we can do things to positively impact our brain, which will then positively impact how our brain functions, our mind and our emotions. So let's talk a little bit about food. What are the foods that help the brain? So the Mediterranean diet has been found to be the healthiest diet for brain health. What's in the Mediterranean diet? It's a whole foods-based diet. So that means it's high in fatty fish, which are high in omega fatty acids, which are very important for brain function. Lots of fresh fruits and vegetables, low processed foods, so junk foods, anything that comes out of a package, and things like nuts and seeds and olive oil. All of those foods are very good for the brain. So if you can choose an apple over a muffin, because sugars are an inflammatory food and shown to not help brain functioning. Any simple changes you can make to the foods you eat can positively impact your brain's functioning. So the next topic we want to talk about is screen time. So these devices have become the center of our lives. And now there are studies showing that the brains of people who use their screens a lot, they're on their phones, they're on their iPads, the gray matter, which is where all of the processing of information in the brain is, they've shown that that shrinks in people who are addicted to their devices or are high users. So if you want a healthy brain, limiting your screen time is very important. It's shown to affect the prefrontal cortex, which is the part of ourselves that is our executive functioning. It's the brakes on our impulsivity. That's our prioritizing and organizing self. And that part of the brain is negatively impacted when we use our devices a lot. So one of the things that you can do is you can do mental exercises. So when I studied the brain 30 years ago, I was taught in neuropsychology that the brain was a fixed system, and that if you had damage in any area of the brain, that you would lose that functioning. Well, that understanding is the equivalent of the planet is flat. what we understand now is that the brain is plastic and that you can do things to improve the neural pathways in the brain, the blood volume that's flowing through the brain, the gray matter mass, which is your dendrites and your neurons, basically the highway of communication in the brain. And there have been a number of studies on the activities that positively impact the brain health, memory, preventing dementia, cognitive functioning. And two of the top activities are learning a language or learning an instrument. And they've even discovered that spending 1 week studying a new language has a positive impact on your cognitive functioning, whatever age you are. So it doesn't mean that you have to spend years becoming proficient in a new language. Just spending time doing novel activities, such as learning language, learning a musical instrument, even things like juggling or learning a new sport like ping pong or pickleball, can positively impact the brain health. So let's talk about a big thing that negatively impacts the brain health, and that is stress. So stress is when our brain is perceiving danger, right? We'll call it worrying about problems, but what the brain is experiencing is a misperception that there is danger in the present moment. And then the limbic brain, which is part of our more primitive brain structure, that's the part of the brain that keeps us safe from danger. It uses the fight, flight, freeze. It produces the stress hormones, sort of keeping us in go mode and making it hard to go into rest and relaxation mode. That part of the brain becomes habituated and reinforced when we have high stress factors in our life. So really looking at how much stress you have, the signs of stress, which is not sleeping well, having a lot of mental rumination, craving salty and sugar foods and overeating, eating at night, being irritable, feeling depressed, like life is hopeless. These can be signs, gut issues. So having difficulties with digestion can also be a sign of stress. So really looking at the stress triggers in our lives and then doing things to counteract them is very important. Number one thing that is the positive impactor to high stress is exercise. So even doing 20 minutes of vigorous walking a day has a really positive impact on stress, as does spending time in nature, being engaged in fun, meaningful activities. So that's another important area to look at in terms of brain health. Okay, so now we're on to the topic of neurofeedback, which is brain training, a very specific kind of brain training. And it's an extension of biofeedback in that we're going to use cues that the brain sends out to then give it feedback so that it can see when it's in maladaptive patterns. And specifically, one of the biggest maladaptive patterns the brain gets into is that stress response patterning. So staying in that fight, flight, freeze energy chronically is very detrimental to the quality of our lives and the health of our brains. And we know it because, as we just discussed, we have a lot of, you know, sort of fear-based or worrying, problem-based focus. We have a hard time accessing our joy. And so with the neurofeedback training, what we're doing is we're basically teaching the brain to pay attention to the here and now. And what is significant about that, if you remember, that stress brain, the limbic brain, is misperceiving the present moment as unsafe, as dangerous. And this is an autopilot part of the brain. It just goes into action. It goes into hyperarousal in that fight, flight, right? So we get a speedy mind. We get, oh my God, I got to get out of here in various ways. We get aggressive and irritable, or we go into the collapse of the freeze response. Why bother? Life is hopeless. We want to just stay in bed. And those are the signs of stress. And that's one of the things we really want the brain to see when it trains with neurofeedback. It can also allow the brain to see other maladaptive patterns that are connected with, you know, anxiety, learning issues such as ADHD. It can help the brain to see that it's caught in habitual patterns around rehabilitation after a head injury or a stroke. So the whole design of neurofeedback is that it uses the electrical activity of the brain to monitor state change in the brain, and then uses some auditory or visual feedback to cue the brain in the millisecond that it needs to see its maladaptive patterns. And again, going back to the principle of neuroplasticity, if the brain now has the opportunity to register what's maladaptive, it's going to then go into action to repair that and change itself to improve its functioning. And so then what you experience is you experience the outcome of that automatic changing that's happening. So you start to sleep better. You can have better quality sleep, sleep longer, less waking up at night. You can notice you feel calmer. You feel more open and aware. You have the ability to pause and contemplate rather than just be in reactive mode. It's easier to let go of mental rumination. You notice you're just cheerful for no good reason. You can focus on work tasks. You can plan and organize in a way that before you would get distracted and overwhelmed. You're noticing you don't have as high a craving for those substances that we use to calm ourselves emotionally. Children will have better emotional regulation, less reactivity to events, a better ability to follow instructions. These are the kinds of things that you see change when you do neurofeedback. And so, of course, when you're doing the neurofeedback and you're de-stressing, right, and you're getting that brain to function better, that improves the overall health of your brain. And of course, we want to have all the variables that we can in place for that good brain health. So including exercising, looking at our nutrition if we can, looking at the quality of our friendships, making sure we're hanging out with high quality people and engaged in meaningful activities like service for others. And when you look at all these things together, then they start to compound and help each other so that everything benefits. So one of the things to keep in mind is that you can't do everything all at once, right? So to start simply, what do you want to start with in terms of your brain health? Do you want to start with doing the neurofeedback? Or do you want to start with focusing on exercising more or looking at your diet? There's no one right way to approach your brain health. What I will say about neurofeedback in my observation of working with people for 12 years, specifically with neurofeedback, is that when that brain starts to re-regulate and calm down and cheer up and be able to focus, is that people naturally start to add other things in as their brain becomes more resourced. So they start to say things to me like, Natalie, you know, I finally decided it's time to go back to the gym. Or, you know, I'm realizing that some of the people I'm hanging out with just make me anxious, and I think I might hang out with them less. Or, okay, now I'm ready to look at my diet. I'm ready to eat less sugar, eat more vegetables, drink less alcohol, or whatever it is, that they start to notice, wow, this is actually detrimental to where I'm trying to get to, you know, in my health, So please think about your brain health. Think about your goals, where you want to get to. Subscribe to our channel. We're sending out videos regularly to support you in your brain health and wellness goals.